This is an illustration of our sermon today.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, good morning. How is everybody today? Oh, come on. How is everybody today? Yeah, woo! That's right. It's the third Sunday of Easter, and we are living resurrected, are we not? Oh, my goodness. Come on. Woo. Was there a party last night that I missed? Wow. This is good. Good. But this is the Sunday also of the readings for a gospel lesson, the guess who's coming to dinner version of the gospel reading. So that is exciting as well. So to be living resurrected, please rise if you are able. Please rise as you are able. Let us sing, "Christ is risen, shout Hosanna," number 383. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us continue our praise of God and of resurrection, singing Hallelujah. You'll find the songs and the words in your bulletin.
Love is
Children, please come forward and please be seated.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
All right, so I've decided I'm going to have lunch here today, and I brought it with me. So before I eat, I'm going to have you guess what I'm making by showing you ingredients, okay? My girls, you can't say anything because you know. All right. What is this?
Bread.
It's bread. Grab a bigger lunchbox. And this? Okay. So who thinks they know so far? Anybody have a guess? What do you think? Okay. What do you think? You're right. Fluff is my last ingredient. That's one of my favorite sandwiches. Do you guys like it too?
I love it.
Yeah, it's my favorite. All right. So, when we make something that has more than one type of food in it, do you know what that's called? Starts with an R. A recipe. All right. Every time I showed you one thing that was in my recipe, it gave you a better idea of what I was going to make, right? So if I just showed you a piece of bread, it could have been 50,000 things. Maybe not 50,000, but a ton of things. You got closer with peanut butter, and then with the fluffer nutter, you got what it was, a fluffer nutter sandwich. So we see a similar thing happen to the disciples in today's scripture. Jesus is resurrected, but disciples haven't seen enough of the resurrected Jesus to understand what it all means. So Jesus helps them see more in today's story. First, Jesus helped them remember who he was. He showed them his scars and then ate with them. They had fish, not fluffernutter sandwiches. Then Jesus talked to them about other scripture stories to help them think about what was currently happening. Then Jesus talked to them about forgiveness and turning their attention to God. The fancy word for that is repentance. Can you guys say that? Repentance. After all of that, Jesus then tells them, "Now that you understand and see what I've been telling you, you can go tell others. So go be witnesses." So remember how you had to see all of the ingredients I had for lunch today before you really knew what I was going to have for lunch? Jesus had to do the same thing with the disciples. He had to help them see how everything fit together before they could clearly tell others what they knew about Jesus. And guess what? It worked. The disciples went out and shared with the people around them what they had learned, sit up, and seen with Jesus. Which is one reason why 2,000 years later, we're still telling stories about Jesus and talking to each other about Jesus, what Jesus taught. And the more we learn about Jesus from the stories, we will be able to share and talk about those stories of Jesus with each other and the people around us. All right, will you guys pray with me? This is a repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for the disciples who shared everything they saw and learned from following Jesus. Please help us do the same. Thank you and amen. All right, guys, thank you so much.
A reading from the book of Acts. Peter addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the Holy and Righteous One and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did all your, also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out." Here ends the reading.
Please rise if you are able. According to Luke. Now Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified, and they thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See, it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, and he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Now, right before Scott had helped me move the lectern, I went back there and asked him, I said, is there a reason and is it possible we can move the lectern to the middle of the podium? And he said, you are the pastor. You can do whatever you want. If you want to turn it upside down, I will do it. True story, right? And so it had me wondering the whole first half of this worship service how that would look, and really, could we do that? Not that I would do that. No. Maybe. So next week, don't be surprised. Don't be surprised. Living resurrected. As I said before, this is guest who's coming to dinner. And for younger generations, it was a movie, okay? Sidney Poitier in the 1960s. It was a big thing, you know, an African-American man dating a white woman, you know, and her bringing her home, him home to dinner. So I can only imagine in that film, just like today, where it says the disciples were terrified, back in the 60s, the parents would have been terrified, I'm sure. But Jesus is living resurrected, right? He has died, he has risen. And he's coming back time and time again to show his friends that he is alive. And everything he spoke about for 3 years has come to fruition. He's having dinner with friends, although he was not invited. Right? Do you ever have one of those friends or family members? Do you have one of those? They show up, always uninvited. You know? They come to dinner or just to hang out. And always like the timing when you're the most tired in your life, right? And you start, as spouses or couples, you start working on clues to give each other when it's time to go home, right? You try to get the word out, right? But these disciples this time, Jesus shows up and they're startled and terrified. And not only that, but he probably didn't bring anything. He didn't bring anything either, right? So who just invites himself and doesn't bring anything for dinner? But Jesus was one of those. It reminded me this past week we had a small family-only funeral luncheon for my brother-in-law. By invitation only. We felt the presence of Jesus as usual, but he still didn't bring anything. But we sat around and shared stories about Tom and had many of stories to share. And I thought it was just truly amazing. I must admit, I broke my hearing aids not too long ago, and I've been carrying them with me, but I haven't had them fixed. So I was at the end of this table of about 20 people, so it's a long table. And so I really couldn't hear what's going on at the other end or in the middle. And so I observed a lot what was going on at this table. But it was pretty funny about how Jesus showed up, about how the people started sharing stories about Tom and what he meant to everybody. And they were just having a good time. Now, remember the Easter egg hunt? I told you about the family Easter egg hunt and about how we have it every Easter. And, you know, it's a free-for-all. The kids get a head start and the older people. Well, Tom was one of those older people that once he jumped off the porch, and he was the oldest member of our family, yet he was in great shape, and he would push over the little kids on purpose as he went. And Tom's about 6'2", and so he had long, gangly arms, and he could just reach out and knock them over, all for fun. And now this was the quiet, demure uncle that they had known, except for Easter. So everybody laughed, and we did, and we cried all about the stories that we were having. We were living resurrected in that moment. And, of course, we made fun of my daughter-in-law because this year she wasn't able to be there at the funeral luncheon and or Easter. And I didn't share this, but right before the service, they called us and let us know that she had fallen down her steps and had broken her neck. quite tragic. And she was hosting Easter. And we didn't miss the dinner as much, but we made fun of her at the luncheon because we weren't able to have our Easter egg hunt then either. I didn't say we were a fair family. It was a little cruel, but we laughed, and we were living resurrected. We called her and let her know we made fun of her. So it was okay, I guess. But sitting around our table, you see, while there were no uninvited guests, there was still distance in the relationships over the last few years. Things had become fragmented for one reason or another. Have you ever experienced anything like this? Not all the family members are talking. Not all the family members are feeling cozy. However, it was a little awkward. It was a little awkward at some moments. However, I believe, like the disciples, the fact that we were gathered there at one table for one purpose, to live a resurrected, honoring our deceased relative like the disciples were doing, it brought us to this understanding. And when I read the scriptures this week, I felt it, that the scriptures, that everything Jesus says about repentance and reconciliation and forgiveness opened up our minds at this moment where we were all gathered to honor the presence of one. And all of a sudden, all those past nuances, all those cracks, all those fissures were closed once again. Because we were there to honor and invited Jesus in our hearts and just to put everything else aside. We were living resurrected, I believe, to live in the moment when Jesus revealed to disciples the true meaning of the scriptures, the law, his commandments, and purpose on earth. It says, then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And I believe in these two short paragraphs in these gospels, depicting an evening where a family of believers are gathered around. And they went from terror and fright to total understanding the key to living resurrected. And, you know, as much as I tell you this every time, the children's message of people that deliver them do not call me and ask me what I'm preaching on, right? They probably rather not. But anyway, so They don't do it. They just do it on their own. And although it's based on the same scripture, I am totally amazed that the messages combine. Whatever wavelength they're on and whatever wavelength, and I can truly believe that God is present. Because, Ariel, you nailed it. Nailed it about the, and I laughed there. I liked at the one point it was effort. Did you hear the one part when she said, and then Jesus told the disciples, and her daughter was like rolling around and doing spinning over, and you go, get up. and without a hesitation, I'm like, and I had to think, did he tell them to get up? Get up. Rise, you know. But anyway, it was great. It was great. I loved it. But you nailed it. You nailed it about being resurrected and about the disciples writing it down. Jesus had to open their minds because back then there were no gospels written. You see, we have that opportunity about living resurrected, about Jesus wants, about repentance and forgiveness and all these things because we have the four gospels that are written in our Bible. We have it. We don't need Jesus to come and appear before us and prove that Jesus is alive, to eat fish and do all these miracles. Because we have the Bible, those four Gospels, it tells us about how to live forgiveness and how to live resurrected. And then if anybody wants to, you know, get out your phone. There's a Bible app on your phone. So if your spouse, your loved one, or your parents are yelling at you being on your phone all the time, make sure you have the Bible app on and just show them. I'm looking at them. They're not making eye contact. No? Don't do that. But you can do that. I mean, you can live resurrected. You could read about things, and we have that. We don't need Jesus to come to dinner and scare and terrify us into believing the things and doing. But living resurrected may require, as in this case, an action as Jesus do to occur to take away the terror and fear. Someone, you see, taking the first step to relieve the tension of living in a moment. In our gospel lesson, Jesus ate the fish in front of them to prove he was not a ghost. In my story, my wife invited everyone, despite their animosity towards one another, to that luncheon. And here's the key, and I'll share this. If you take nothing else away from my sermon today, listen to what she taught me. She said, Scott, you do it by not sending out a group text. You copy and paste. You take one text inviting everybody to the luncheon, and you just send it to one person at a time. That way, because when you do get a group text, what do? You look to see who else is invited. We're human. You take the humanity part and get it down to what it was really important by sending it to one person at a time. And then all they see is I'm going there to honor my loved one, and I'm invited to the table. That I learned. As I observed our funeral luncheon, people on the outside once again were invited in through the actions of one who had understanding of what it means to live a Christian life. People once like ghosts, and that's how you feel when you're on the outside or you're separated from your loved one. People once like ghosts were present and ate and laughed with the rest. We were living, resurrected. I believe the good news is that Jesus every day lives in us, the body of believers. Through lessons of life, he reveals to us the total understanding of the scriptures. And like the disciples, we are encouraged to leave the room and go into the world and take action to invite those who are like ghosts and forgotten to us and bring them back into our home, our church, and yes, invite them to the table. For them and to us to live resurrected. Amen. Well, I ask you to please rise as you are able. And with the words of God and Jesus' invitation, it makes us all a little bit stronger.
You are Lord of all. You are.
one body in Christ. Allow us to profess our faith in Jesus Christ, God, and the Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and have given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together by Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ might live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us pray for the world and all those in need. God of peace, it surely doesn't seem that way. We pray, Almighty God, that this world may truly find peace. New threats of war on our doorsteps each day. New violence in our streets, our schools, and our worship places are happening. People of faith in fear and terrified to gather outdoors for the fear of eruption of violence and hate. God of peace, we need that peace now. God of grace. God of reality. As Jesus ate to calm the unbelievers, allow us to be fully seeing, fully believing, and fully aware of the risen Christ and our own resurrection, so that we can reach out to those who cannot see themselves the goodness of your love. God of grace. And God of healing, we pray, Almighty God, for those that are not with us and those who cannot be with us because they're hospitalized or in care or therapy, dear Lord. We pray for their doctors and their caregivers and their nurses and the therapists and their technicians, dear Lord, and all those that you put in their hands for healing. Give them the spiritual wisdom and discernment upon them so that they can bring them back home and to bring them to health. We especially pray for those we say aloud now or silently in our heart. Okay. Sandy. Patty. Almighty and gracious God, bring them the healing they so desire. God of grace. And God of evangelism, teach us not to be afraid and terrorize ourselves for being who we are. Resurrected believing through our baptism and our choice by you to serve you. Allow us to be an example to others that are floundering, dear Lord, or ghost themselves from you. And let them bring them home to join the table in a feast that never ends. God of grace. God of saints, we especially pray for those loved ones who have gone before us. We pray for Tom Flagel and all those saints and our loved ones. Dear Lord, be with their families and helping them in their grieving. God of grace. Almighty and gracious God, we ask, offer these prayers of petition. petitions unto you and those that are in our heart that go unspoken. Your Lord's Son, Jesus Christ, knows them before we ever speak them. So in his name we pray. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So before we get in peace, I encourage you again, as we said when we started in reintroducing the peace in our worship service, a lot of people were saying, hey, we don't know each other because we used to go to the early service or we went to the late service and there's all these new people and everything else. So take the time and effort as somebody you don't know. Introduce yourself. Let them know your name and welcome them here. So since we are justified by faith, we have peace through God, through our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace of Christ be with you always. Please share a sign of peace and love with one another. I'm still thinking, Scott. I think we can do this. We'll have to remove this. No, I know. Just say the word. I know. Oh, we don't want people to have heart failures and be terrified. That's in the gospel. But I want to thank everybody for announcement today for our Word in Season. Thank you, Steve and Faye, for your sponsorship of our Word in Season devotion booklets. The new ones are out there. Also, if you have an opportunity for your loved ones to honor them or to also to memorialize somebody by sponsoring our flowers. Aren't they beautiful today? And they every Sunday they're beautiful. But sponsoring the flowers or the bulletin, it's a way of showing, commemorate our loved ones. So please take that opportunity. You can find it at newhanoverlutheran.org in our sign-up section on there, or just call the office and set it up with Susan and gladly do it. Today, there is a lot going on. If you have missed it and then you said, oh, we didn't sign up, and you can come. Today we're having everybody's birthday party this afternoon from 2 to 4 p.m. in the fellowship hall. So we're celebrating everybody's birthday in there. Read up there. The decorated bags will be distributed to the children of the families who are served by the Pottstown Cluster Food Pantry. So there is a, we're assembling birthday bags for them. But we're going to have play games or have cake and ice cream like any other party, and with a mission intent to help out those children that are served from the Pottstown Food Pantry. So come on out, help other families who can't help themselves, but also just enjoy yourself. Have a great time from 2 to 4 p.m., ice cream and cake. It doesn't get any better than that. Right on a Sunday afternoon, and just come on out right here in the fellowship hall. Don't worry about signing up. Just come on out. If you want to put your name on the list, that's fine, but just come on out. Also today, does it seem like we announce a lot about food? Okay. Well, that's what we are. That's what we do. Anyway, today is the deadline to order hoagies. Our fantastic scouts that are here have their hoagie sale fundraiser going on. It's in the Welcome Center in there. Sign up. Today is the last day. You can pick them up on April 27th. But Italian and turkey hoagies, their cost is only $7 for it, and it goes towards a good cause for the scouting. So anyway, go down there, sign up. The sheet's down there in the Welcome Center. Help out. I know Scott Repa and Andy are in the back there, and you got Nikki running around. They're all very involved. They'll let you know about how you can do it and help out the scouting. I see some scouting families in there as well. You can raise your hands. Go ahead, raise your hand. Okay. Yep. Okay, scouts. And then go see them and help them out and find out how you can buy some hoagies. Next Sunday is a Sunday to come because I won't be speaking. The youth are speaking, right? All right. And the infamous words that I will be here, the infamous words from a worship planning center a couple years ago was, just get your butt there anyway. It came out of the wows of somebody there when I said, well, I should just take off. They go, no, just get your butt there anyway and support the youth. So I will be here supporting the youth. And then so next Sunday, and there'll be a special collection there for the Flutter group. That's our youth group that meets, and they do a phenomenal job getting together like we get together and just have fun, and but also in the spirit and building a presence here of God for our youth. And so come next Sunday. It's a special offering also to help our youth group. And then we're going to have another party. The weekend, you know, April 28th, let's applaud everybody. We are retiring our debt from our audio, vision, electrical system. Hey, praise be to God. Yep. So we paid off our $60,000 and it rose above that, but we paid that and the money's coming in, and that's good because we're still paying off our heating and air conditioning. And like I promised the other week, no, we will not turn off the air conditioning so it makes you give. You know, we're not going to do that. We're not going to, maybe. I no, it depends. So we have about $60,000 to pay off. Let's continue our good work, and thank you very much for everybody. Adults, today back in room 33, we're kicking off our adult Bible study. Have a beautiful, terrible day. It's a great study. It's a book by Kate Baller, and this is a woman who has lived life, divinity school professor, but, she's pregnant, and then she finds she has stage 4 cancer with her first child. Baby's fine. Kate's fine. She's just teaching about life, and she delivers it from a different perspective, like, oh, it's Jesus, we're all blessed. She's like, oh, it's Jesus, you know, it's like, I'm having a terrible day. And we all have those days, and we have those things in life. So the prayers, the meditations, the readings are all doing and walking with somebody on a journey that has felt pain and suffering just like you and I. And it's truly refreshing and a way to study and to be with each other in devotion and studying. And so it's called Have a Beautiful, Terrible Day. You can join us. I have books back there, but we can order more books and just join us. Or if you want to do it at home, like some people are doing, we'll get books, or you can get them online. Just see me, and I'll let you know. Also then, the Gathering of Daughters is May 5th, noon, in honor of Mother's Day. And what else? There's a lunch. Imagine that. But anyway, go there. And there's many other things that going. And speaking about food, our last announcement, Chef Chris is back from vacation, so he has veggie soup, roast beef, and mashed potatoes. He called them smashed potatoes, so it must be his recipe. And chicken salad and chicken noodle soup in there. So if you want to have lunch before you come back and have ice cream and cake, there's plenty of good vittles out there. So go out there in the fellowship hall, and all that will be waiting for you. So please rise as you are able. And let us sing together, the strife is over, the battle is done, number 366. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Go get them.